What I love about the Enneagram is it will affect all the areas of your life. The reason being is 9 times out of 10, or let's even probably say something like 98 times out of 100, probably your problems are not based on what's happened, they're based on how you're processing what's happened. And they're also, the problems that you have are often based on the actions you're taking and where you're putting yourself and how you're showing up. So as you get healthy as your type, you will put yourself in healthier positions around healthier people, make healthier choices. When problems come to you, you will be more dynamic. You won't lean into your type and get really unhealthy. You will draw upon all the qualities of all the types, and you'll be able to be way more flexible in dealing with those problems.
Hello, welcome to Soul Awakenings with Madiha Sosan podcast, and today we have Mickey Owen. Mickey is a teacher of the Enneagram with an integral perspective, blending psychology, spirituality, and real-world applications. He and his partner Emma specialize in the area of conscious relationships and spiritual development as a vehicle for achieving balance and overall well-being. Now, we had Mickey and Emma on the podcast before. We talked quite a lot about relationships, and he has so much wisdom to share. I had to bring him back on. So without further ado, let's bring him on. Hey, Mickey, how's it going, bro?
Very, very good. How are you?
Yeah, not too bad, not too bad. So you're like, you're on this podcast second time. And yeah, so today you're going to be talking about Enneagrams, right? You're looking rather different. Yeah. You just went through a haircut.
Freshly snipped.
Yeah. How's Emma? And also, you've got newborn as well?
Yes, yes. So Emma's an incredible mom. She's been amazing. Oh, yeah. So good. Aww. So loving, so attentive, so, you know, on the ball with it all. She's amazing. We seem to have a happy baby. I think those days when he cries a lot, I have to remind myself that actually this is a good day for some parents.
I'm going to see him on over the weekend, and I can't wait. It's going to be so good. I haven't seen you guys for a while, you know. So, you know, you've been doing quite a lot of work on Enneagrams. You know, last time you were on the podcast, we were talking about relationships, all types. So, you know, it was like an hour, 40 minute or something, like almost 2 hour episode. And it was amazing. So many nuggets to take away from that episode. So to those listeners who don't know who you are, would you like to introduce yourself?
Yeah, so Mickey Owen is the name I go by, actually called Michael Owen. And when you say who I am, you're a little bit of a bio, right? Kind of my thing, yeah. So I live in North England, not too far from you, right? Very much into personal development, spiritual journeys, being the last decade of my life, maybe a little more, maybe 15 years, all leading towards a few epiphanies, which actually when we go into this topic today, it'll be a little bit more revealing because it's very Enneagram relevant, my life. My whole life has been very relevant, as everybody's is, to my type. So a lot of searching, a lot of dipping my toes in this and that and looking here and looking there and seeking, and really kind of come to a place in my life now where things are really, really coming together and crystallizing with a lot of clarity and a lot of focus, and things really just clicking into place. And now what I do is I use everything I've learned and that I continue to learn on this journey and teach it to others and help others, guide others where possible, a little bit of mentorship here and there. That's pretty much my jam. Other than that, now a family man and just like to keep fit, work out, eat well, apart from the sweets. And I think travel as well, once little man's a little bit older, a little bit more travel again.
Yeah, amazing. I absolutely love the work that you do. You know, you come from, you talk about like experiencing it and then going out and teaching it. You know, there's a time of, what I'm finding is there is time and place, where you are learning, you're the student, and then comes the time when you are actually teaching it. And, you know, it's such a beautiful feeling, you know, because then people take away what you've learned and they apply it in their lives and you see their transformation and difference, right?
Yeah. And then the other bonus as well of teaching is you never forget. If you're teaching it frequently, you have to embody what you teach, right? Because it's constantly right in the front of the mind. So, you know, there's probably a selfish aspect to my teaching as well. As much as I want to help everyone else, it makes my own life even better because I love what I do. And it helps me stay ahead of the curve in terms of my own development. I can't just put things down. I can't say for this month I'm not going to do anything to help myself because it's constantly there, you know.
Yeah, filling your own cup up, it's so important, really, really important, you know. You have to be the role model. You have to do the things you're teaching, you know. And you can't just go on stage, and I can't just go on stage and say, well, guys, sit with your feelings, and I'm not doing any of that. Which is like, of course, I have to go through all of that and then come out at the other end. It's like, guys, look at this. This is gold. And you can find that in yourself as well. So let's get into what is Enneagram.
Okay. Do you know, it's taken me a while to kind of really find a good way to answer this question that I find is clear and easy for somebody to grasp if they don't know anything whatsoever about it. First of all, the Enneagram is a symbol, and it's called Enneagram because it's got 9 points. This is the Ennea. It's like a nine-pointed shape. This is where Ennea comes from. So that's the name of it. But actually what it is a model that helps us to understand that there are 9 very distinct personality types of people. And it tells us what creates those types of people, what it is that's making those 9 personalities be the way that they are, what's holding them together. So probably a good place to start would be in childhood. We sense some kind of danger or some kind of a threat or some kind of we have a sense that in our house things are not necessarily the way that we would like them to be. And so what happens is we start to create coping strategies. If I be more like this, it tends to neutralize this threat that I'm sensing in my holding environment, in my home. And so I start to lean into this coping strategy. I'll just do this from now on. It seems to make things a little bit better at home. So I'll keep doing that. And what happens is we have different coping strategies, like lots and lots of them, and from ego fixations to these emotional patterns and thought patterns and defense mechanisms and so on and so forth. And we've got loads of them. And they all click together. They're very intricate and interconnected, and they work together to give us a personality. So what is a personality? It is the sum total of all these coping strategies that we learn from childhood. Then what happens is the environment that we're brought up in, the holding environment, whatever sense we had there becomes our worldview. So if you think when you're a child, your home and your home environment is your whole world, right? That's all you know. There's nothing outside of that. It's your parents, your siblings, you know, your immediate family who you live with and the house that you're in and the places that you go. This is your holding environment. And whatever you see that as unsafe, a lot of despair, a lack of connection, you know, however you see that, there's not enough, there's scarcity. You take that view and that becomes your worldview for the rest of your life. And this is your personality. To deal with that worldview, I lean into my coping strategies and I'm safe in that world that I am seeing out there. And in that, we also then develop this, how can I solve the problems? I want to feel safe and solve the problems in the world that I'm experiencing. So this is what the Enneagram is. It is a model for showing you that. How are you seeing the world? How are you put together psychologically and thoroughly? Your whole being is extremely succinct and clear about that. And how are all these patterns working together to make up your personality? So then you might ask, why do you need to know your personality? Like, what's the use of knowing what your personality is? Like, how is that helpful? A couple of things I would say. The first one being, it helps you go easy on yourself. for all the things that you don't like about yourself and the things that you struggle with and the things that you find, you know, the challenges, the self-sabotaging patterns that you have. You can kind of see it a little bit more objectively. You can look at it and go, ah, this is what my type does. It's not me that's defective. 1 in 9 people do this thing and have this same challenge in their own way. Okay, that kind of makes it a little bit less personal and a little bit more objective. I can see that this is a challenge of my type. So that's one thing on a very kind of immediate personal level. And then there's something that goes much deeper than that, which is when we're running these patterns, we're looking from the psychological pattern, we're looking from the defense mechanism, we're looking at the worldview. The reason we have that worldview is we're looking through all our coping strategies. So when you're looking from them, they run you. You're completely controlled by them. And that is you being owned by your personality. So whatever the personality dictates, you must do in a certain scenario, you will go do it. And you basically don't have a choice. The Enneagram is extremely clear about what these things are. So what you can start to do is look at them. You're no longer looking from them, you're looking at them. And when you look at them, you no longer are them, right? So you become liberated from them. Now, that's not to say it's easier. That makes it sound easy. It's not. It's simple, but it's definitely not easy because we lose presence, right? We lose the presence to go, oh, I need to remember to look at this pattern. And you just get caught up in the personality and you run all the patterns. And then you have a moment of presence and go, oh, I've been doing my thing again. I've been doing that thing. That's why I've got myself in this problem. That's why I feel like this old familiar feeling of I feel stuck or I feel trapped in my case. And maybe feel frustrated. It's because I'm doing my personality. Okay, present. Take a breath. Watch. All right, my mind's doing that. My emotions are doing that. My defense mechanism's doing this. I can see it all now. Okay. When you can see it all, you're free from it. You're not it. So that's what I would say is a good, nice summary of what the Enneagram is.
I would say, like, you know, being aware. It's like sometimes I'm doing a certain things in terms of type 7 and I just like don't even recognize it until after it's done. So even when you're triggered, so I was like, whoa, okay, that was the type 7 thing to do.
I mean, so especially like, when you're triggered, right? That's mm-hmm. what a trigger is, where you go, ow, that hurts, quick, grab those coping mechanisms as hard as I can. Personality grabs you and controls you for the next, I don't know, 10 minutes or something like that, for some people longer.
So can people, is there a way to change your types, or is it, this is how it's, that's it, that's you, you can't change it?
What I love about the Enneagram is it's extremely versatile and dynamic. It's a moving shape. So yes, you will always be the same type. And people sort of would say, I'm really different to how I used to be. How can I be the same type? I've changed loads. What that we're referring to there, which is something we could get into a little bit, is the levels of health. It's how fixated in the personality are you? You do a lot of inner work, you're still going to have the same essence, the same personality, you're still the same type, the same archetype, but you're a healthier version of it. And so that can look very different to the unhealthy version of it. So just for example, as type sevens, because we both have that as our primary point, our core type is a type seven. When we're really fixated, that can look like flamboyant exaggerations. It can look like excuses, not being reliable, not taking responsibility, being immature, you're rationalizing things away, doing things that you ought not to do, and then rationalizing it away, making it okay in your own head. It can look like being thoughtless. It can look like being selfish. These are the things when you're really fixated. When you get healthy, you become joyous. You become a real pleasure for people to be around. You uplift people. You make people smile. You make people laugh. You have a very good, wise head on your shoulders. You see patterns everywhere that becomes wisdom, and you can use that in your own life and to help other people and uplift and become very creative and very prolific and tend to be very innovative. So like Leonardo da Vinci, for example, was type 7. So can do lots of different things well.
And they go through a rapid transformation as well. Like if you really fixate on it, it's like push, 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 gone. Yeah. But we'll talk about the type. So Let's go through them. What are they from? So there are nine types.
Yes. Yeah. The symbol is on that clock just behind me and also just here.
Oh, yeah.
So that's the symbol you can see. So at the top there would be number nine. And then going around clockwise, is it goes 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, back to nine at the top. So let's start with type one. And there, the names, some people agree with using the names per type. Some people don't. They say it's a little bit too pigeonholey. You know, putting people in a pigeonhole, putting people in a box. And there's a very famous saying in the world of Enneagram, which is the Enneagram doesn't put you in a box. It shows you the box that you have put yourself in or that you have been put in and shows you the way out of it, which I really like. So type one are known as reformers, sometimes known as the perfectionist, because they can always see that things should be or could be better. They could be more perfect, more correct. They have a view in the world of they see things that are mistakes everywhere. That's incorrect. That's incorrect. That's incorrect. That's it. That's correct. I'll follow that. I'll use that as one of my guides. That's morally correct. Very morally guided. And so it's not just data and precision analysis. It's morally guided perfection, morally guided correctness. And so they always want to make other people better, make themselves better, make the world better. So they're trying to reform all the time. So that's a type one. And type two are known as the caregiver. Or the helper is another name given to them. And they're very much like tend to fall into roles such as things like doctors and nurses and healthcare workers and people who are tending to the needs of others. They're very nurturing, nourishing, want to make sure people feel seen, feel heard, feel as though that there's somebody there for them, like the special friend, if you like. And they would have loved to, for example, be on the front line during the pandemic would be a really good example. The people who put everybody else first, big hearts, they're all about love and affection. And so they are kind of people call them the hearts of the Enneagram. They're very much all about love.
Oftentimes, are they like a fallen category of nurses, kind of that kind of caretakers and caregivers?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, absolutely. I just want to, they have learned when they were a child, they learned that when I see to the needs of others, I get my needs met. So the more I care for others, the more other people will care for me. And so we're all doing this. We all say, if I do this, you will do this. If I run this character, then you will meet my needs. And so that's theirs. Help others, serve and be served. But they interestingly struggle to receive the help. They give it and give it and give it, and they struggle to receive it, even though that's the reason they're giving it in the first place. So it's very interesting. We're all kind of doing that, trying to get the thing and then pushing it away at the same time. This is the limitation of the personality itself. So type three, sometimes they're called the performer, sometimes they're called the achievist. I've heard there's a few different names. So these are the people who like to do well at life, who like to be number one. They like to achieve, they like to be successful, they like to stand out in their own way. They are very self-conscious, image-conscious, very, very image-conscious. And in their childhood, they were valued in their household for achieving something, right? So imagine this, when you're a child, you do something and your parents look at you and they go, wow, wow, you know that look? And the three spends their life trying to get that from everybody. They want the people to look at them and go, wow, you're amazing. How did you do that? So, oh, I'm impressed. They want to impress people. They want to be validated by people. So these people tend to be at the top of things like Olympics, probably very, and I would say definitely very prone to wanting to be famous. A lot of them wanting to be actors and actresses and models. Think people who are kind of the poster child, they're very much like role models. Think of Will Smith, think of Arnold Schwarzenegger, people who they're kind of at the top of the game and they achieve lots and lots of things. I mean, that would have really hurt Will Smith. What happened there, his image being wrecked. It would have been extremely difficult for him because he's a very obvious strong three. And so that would have been hard for him because he's all about image. And to do what he was trying to do there is be the perfect husband, right? If you remember, he was laughing along and then he saw that she was unhappy. And then he went and did something trying to be the perfect husband because he wants to be the role model husband. So this is what threes are like. They want to be what they feel they ought to be to gain the admiration of others. Type four, known as the romantic or the individualist. They're all about depth and originality. Really want to feel seen, want to be understood. Feels like nobody quite understands them. Normally very creative, artistic, in whether that's through words or poetry or art or movement, dance, normally into some kind of creativity. And it really comes from a place of they're extremely emotional, and they experience the whole spectrum of emotions more than all the other types. They have a full spectrum of very, very nuanced and subtle emotions.
Mm-hmm.
And so their inner world is very colourful and vibrant with feelings. And so bearing that in mind, then their creativity kind of comes from there. They write from that place. Rumi, and you might know of Rumi. Rumi was a type four, a beautiful poet that's kind of touched the world through words. And so this stuff comes up and out, and you can kind of see it and be like, wow, you know, it gives you that, you feel it deep inside. It has oomph to it, it has a depth, it has a real connection to the heart. So that's where their creativity comes from. It comes up and out like that. They like to be unique. And this is that paradoxical thing, right? It's like, I really feel like I want to belong, but I want to stand out. But I feel like I don't belong, and I want everyone to see me for who I am. So I will express who I am really vividly, but then I don't fit in and people don't understand me. So they kind of, that's that little paradox. Some of the famous fours that I know of, say Johnny Depp. They can be quite solemn a lot of the time, and very comfortable, we could say, or familiar with sadness, and like to and tend to sit in sadness. Some of them do enjoy it. Some of them say they don't enjoy it, but it's home. Some of them say, I like it. It's real. It's raw. It's authentic. All about authenticity. That's the four. Then we've got the five. I have a soft spot for fives. So this tends to happen. Like there's certain types that people will be drawn to. And for me, it's fives. I use this in an endearing way, like the nerds of the Enneagram. They are normally very intellectual in their own way. They are experts. They like to find a thing and become an expert in that thing. This is their thing. I need to be useful. I need to master something. I need to be good at something. They are all about knowledge, data. Give me the data. Give me the knowledge. Show me where the science papers are. Show me what the facts say. I want the facts. So whereas the ones, for example, are very morally guided, fives are all about data. Like what's actually proven, what's right. Fives tend to feel like an alien in the world. They feel like they don't belong as well. Very, very cerebral, very introspective. Quite happily just stay locked away in a room with loads and loads of books and just read and learn their whole lives. That's kind of very stereotypical of a five. Not often people like to keep themselves to themselves. Very precious about their space, about their time, and about their energy. Don't intrude on my space, time, and energy, because everything's scarce. Them things are scarce. I need to hold on to what I have. So that's
why the introverts kind of just fit in that category perfectly.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. It's like very contained, isn't it? It's a contractive, contained energy. And then we have sixes. So sixes, I've always found to be the most complex. And when I've worked with sixes, they tend to say, I'm complex. I don't think you'll be able to type me on there because I feel like I've got more than one personality. So sixes are very much like that. I've heard it described as they're a bunch of opposites. So they might be very fearful and they're also very courageous. They'll be very, very loyal and your best friend, and they'll also can be your worst enemy. And sixes do tend to divide people into friends and enemies very easily.
Oh, that's interesting.
Yeah, very easily. So they can, they're known as the loyalist. And so that is their thing. It's like, I feel unsafe in this world. I don't feel secure. And so for me to feel safe and secure, I will stand by somebody else and be extremely loyal to them, somebody that I feel will keep me safe and someone I can trust. And I will be extremely loyal to that person and look after them. And when I do that, they will look after me. And the more they look after me, the more I will look after them. So it's very much an us energy, me and you against the world. And there's always an us and a them, a very strong us and them energy. Mike Tyson is a type six. Eminem is a type six. So you kind of get that vibe of the us and the them. Not all of them are that robust, if you like. Some people are very, very gentle, warm type sixes as well.
They very much trust is a big thing for them. You know, they don't trust people easily either. That's what I found in type six are very much trust is their biggest thing, where they just will not trust you or anybody around them unless they really, 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 you do nothing wrong.
I've still got one eye on you. No matter how much you prove yourself to them again and again, they're very hypervigilant and they're always checking, making sure that can I still trust you though? And they'll poke and test as well.
Yeah. And that's so irritating. God, it's so irritating. I know it's like all personality types are amazing, but it's like so irritating. It's like, oh.
We're all irritating in our own way, though, believe me. I'm always careful never to single out an Enneagram type, because that always says more about me than it does about them. If ever we think, oh, I don't like that about that type, it's normally something work that we need to do as well. It can absolutely be that. Just for an example, as sevens, we want everything to always be positive and fun and playful and vibrant. So when they come all serious and poking and testing, it's like, oh, man, you're dragging me down. Stop doing that, man. Come on. Like, can't we just get back to having fun again?
Yeah.
It says more about us, because if we were okay with those lower end of the emotions, we would go, okay, what do you want? There's something happening. I'll be there for you. Let's work on this right now. What would you like? Let's make this better. And that's what they want. They want that instant reaction, positive reaction. They want you to get in there with them. Realize there's a problem. Okay, there's a problem. Let's get on it now. Let's not try and belittle it. Let's not diminish your problem that you're seeing. Let's not try and get away from it. Let's deal with it here and now. And when we can do that, that's what they're after. I mean, ultimately, it's up to them to eventually to grow out of that, to evolve up those levels and stages. And it's up to us, for example, as sevens, to grow out of our need to always be happy and joyous. But we can't change the other person. We can only work on ourselves. So for us, we just work on
keep on just growing and expanding in certain ways, and they can as well.
So that's the sixth, the loyalist, sometimes known as the skeptic as well. They're very skeptical. They have a doubt in mind. A constant inner what if. But what if this? What if that? Second guessing everything, planning everything, thinking of worst case scenarios. So that's the six. So then we have the seven. Seven constantly have restless energy, so I move around a lot, constantly restless, constantly thinking about the next exciting thing, the next big idea, or the next tantalizing, maybe it's the next meal, maybe it's the next holiday, maybe it's the next business idea I have. Brilliant at brainstorming, love coming up with things. Not so much fun doing the follow through and taking care of all the little details and minutiae and the admin and all the responsible stuff, like balancing your checkbooks and doing your accounts and things like that. I don't even know why I said balance your checkbook. Who has a chat? I don't know if that's even a thing. Doing your accounts, paying bills, doing normal admin. It's very difficult for a seven because we just want to have fun and play and do all the good stuff and leave out all the boring responsibility. Sevens want to do everything all at once. Like, I'm interested in so many things, right? I've got 20 things that I'm interested in, and I would be interested in more, but I don't have time to find out more because I'm doing these things. And it's like, I'm doing this and I'm all about this thing and I'm going right into it, but what's that shiny thing over there? Fling it over the shoulder, next thing.
I feel like that's so relatable.
Well, type sevens are known as the enthusiast, and they're also known as the optimist, because they're the most optimistic, most positive minded out of all the types. Just to know they can still be suffering a lot. But I'll give you an example of a low level optimism, because we can still get really depressed, right? So the lower end of the type seven, I can remember this from being a kid. It's just like, if there was, I remember being at school and there was the scissors that we used to use in craft at school. I was really young. And all the boys wanted the ones with the blue handles, right? Everybody had to get the blue ones. And they were all gone and all that was left was green. So I just made green my favorite color. You know, I'm like, oh, my favorite color is green anyway. I don't want the blue ones. So really, I was a bit miserable that, but I was just kind of making the best of a bad situation. I'll just reframe the situation, make myself prefer what I have there. That makes sense. So this is kind of a really common seven-ish thing. And this is why they're not necessarily, they find it difficult to be really honest about things, because the excuses, the rationalizations, the reframes, you kind of lose a grip on reality when you're fixated as a seven. And it can make it difficult to just be open and honest, because you're constantly trying to make everything be happy and good. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So if somebody hurts your feelings, it's hard to kind of sit and go, ow, and go, that really hurt my feelings. It's easier to go, do you know what? I don't even care what you think, and push them away when really you do. It's harder to be honest with things like that. You'll also notice with sevens, they might say, how are you? Oh, I'm having a good day, but everything's all right. I'm not having a good day. Sorry, I'm not having a good day. I'm having a bad day. Things are, but it's all right. I'll get through it. So the whenever they say something negative, they'll normally, the voice will raise up a couple of notches and then almost bury it with a positive.
Yes.
The pattern that you see in sevens.
Yeah.
Very enthusiastic and move around a lot, like me. So I just noticed, I didn't say the names of type fives that people give them, the thinker and the investigator, the names that are given to the fives. So the type eights are the next one, and the last one. Oh, no, we're going up to nine. We didn't start at nine. Sometimes I start at nine because it's at the top and work around. So eight, known as the challenger, known as the leader, big, powerful, strong, like a rock, grounded, all quite angry, quick to anger, find it easy to be angry, and then to just put the lid back on it, and then be really angry again and put the lid back on it. So their anger can be a problem for other people, but it's not really a problem for them. It's home. It's normal. They are trailblazers. They will challenge the status quo. They're not afraid of confrontation. They see a lot of injustice out in the world. They see that the big man picks on the little guy, you know. They see that everywhere, and so they constantly feel that they have to give a voice to the underdog and stand up to the big man, you know. This often came from having the same dynamic in their parents, in their house, that one bullied the other, so they stuck up for the one that was getting bullied. And that's how they then see the world. They suppress their vulnerability. They mustn't show weakness, mustn't show signs of being soft, weak, vulnerable. I need to be strong and powerful, have a good hard shell. Command respect, like to be respected. Very charismatic normally, big energy in the room. Alpha status, like the alpha male or the alpha female. Very blunt, just say what needs to be said, get it said, don't worry about it. If they have a problem with it, that's their problem. I haven't got time for weaklings. So this is a paradox. I don't have time for weaklings, but I want to stand up for weaklings. So the thing that makes a difference is if that vulnerable or the weaker person in that, the person who's been bullied or whatever that looks like, if that person's willing to stand up for themselves, the eight will get behind them. But if they're not, if they're just crying victim, playing victim and not standing up for themselves whatsoever, but they should be able to, but they're not, then the eight dismisses them. You're not trying to help yourself. I'm not going to help you. So that's the eight, challenger, leader, tend to be leaders. Don't like to be, they will not be controlled. You know, I won't let people control me. I control other people, or I control my life. I'm very independent. I control where I go, what I do and how I do it. Take up a lot of space in a room. You know, they're happy to take up space.
Yeah.
So that's the eight. And finally, the nine is the peacemaker, known as the peacemaker or the peacekeeper or the mediator. So my partner, Emma, is a nine. This is another one that I have soft spots for, is a type nine. Very gentle, loving, inclusive, diplomatic, calm, comfortable, want everybody to be comfortable all the time. They struggle with taking care of themselves. They always put themselves last, which can be really challenging in a relationship that I always have to keep checking in, you know, and making sure, are you doing this because you want to do this? Or are you doing this because I want to do this? Because nines will go along to get along. They want everybody to feel important, and they want, and they choose themselves to be nobody important, to sink into the background, self-effacing, they call it, like rubbing themselves out. Their view of the world and the way that they're experiencing the world is that everything's always, there's tension, and it's always on the verge of some kind of a conflict breakout. And so I must always pacify everybody, right? I must keep everybody comfortable and calm. And when everyone's comfortable and calm, I can relax. But if one person's out of, you know, they're not calm and they're irate, then the nine's like, oh, okay, I'm anxious now. I need to calm them, calm down. You know, so they deal a lot with that, and they deal with a repression of anger. So the nine, because anger leads to conflict, is how they see it. Anger leads to conflict, so the anger gets repressed completely. So nines will pretty much always say, I'm not an angry person. Pretty much every nine, I'm just not an angry person.
But there's a lot of anger inside.
Incredible Hulk, right? It's Bruce Banner. Bruce Banner is really always trying to keep himself calm. He has to, otherwise he turns green, tears things to pieces. But then with a lot of nines, when it does go, if it ever does, and it might never go, when it does, it's really comes out really clunky and immature, because it's never had any airtime. It's never grown up. It's never matured with the individual. It's kind of always been piled down and stuck down, and it sort of stays childish. So it'll come up and it might be very tantrumy, very stubborn, and then they'll put the lid on and then they'll feel really bad about it. And so it's like very prone to people pleasing as well.
So, oh my God, that's like so much information going in, right? It's like about Enneagrams. You're barely scratching the surface of it, you know? It's like,
yeah, absolutely, yeah.
Obviously, we have ego fixations and childhood wounds. I mean, if you go through them with all our types, then it will be here, ours. So let's just talk about ours, mine and yours. So we are type seven. So what is the ego fixation for type sevens? And also, what is the unhealthy and the healthy, and also a childhood wounds that's mixed together? So,
okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I'll start with the childhood wound, because it makes sense to do it that way. That's right from the beginning. So the childhood wound was that nurturing was taken away too soon. I was always left wanting more. So it could be that you were breastfed and you were taken off the breast too soon, maybe too early in life, and you suddenly the nutrients weren't there. That feeling of satiation, that satiety that lives in the body, where you go, oh, I'm content, that's enough. You're like, you didn't get that again and again and again. So it could be that you were taken off the breast too soon. It could be that you had a busy mom and she took you off too soon at each feeding time. It could be that mom used to play, which normally on the mother, it's on the mother's side. And that's part of some types of masculine side towards the reacting to the father figure, and some are reacting to the mother figure. Sevens, we react to the mother figure. And the nurturing, the maternal energy was taken away too soon. So that could be like mom's playing with you on the carpet, playing game, playing Lego, playing whatever with teddies. And every time you felt like she had to get up and leave before you'd had enough. And you kind of left there feeling a little bit empty and a little bit disappointed. The sevens really don't like disappointment, don't like being let down, don't like things being taken away halfway through. They have a huge fear of missing out as well. So this is the childhood wound, constantly left in this frustrated, I need more. It's not all the way there, which is why we're so restless. We wanted to get onto the next thing, trying to get more. And that's what speaks to the ego fixation, which some people call it planning, and I've also heard it called anticipation. Personally, I like anticipation more. That makes more sense to me, because it's not always in the sense of planning, but planning means let's think of the next exciting thing I can do. Let's plan the next thing that might actually finally fill this deep perpetual hunger state. It might finally satisfy that, and I'll experience that contentment that I've been looking for. And so it's constantly planning for the next thing. I find anticipation is a better description, because sometimes I'm not planning, but I'm just anticipating that something good's about to happen. That's always there. Constant anticipation.
I get that. Because even if you're nothing's coming in, but there's something. There's always something.
It's that positive thing, right? That's the positivity as well. That's the optimism. It's like, something good's about to happen. Something good's about to happen. It's this constant feeling that something's going to scratch that itch sooner or later. And the reason we have that as well is when we were left disappointed, we would say, do you know what? It's okay. Like I said, as a kid, I'll just pretend that I want to play on my own then. I'll just make the best of what I've got, and I'll enjoy it and make it into a game, and I'll reframe it and make it positive, so I don't have to feel disappointed and sad, because I don't like feeling that way. So that's where that came from. Was there another one in there? There was the childhood wound, the ego fixation.
Ego fixation, childhood wounds, and the healthy and unhealthy. So it's like moving up. So what is unhealthy for type sevens?
I kind of touched on it earlier, what it looks like, the flamboyant exaggerations and things like that versus being very productive and prolific and being good at many things. But what that looks like in terms of what's going to make you get unhealthy, what's going to make that happen, is first of all, you find, I'm thinking loads, I'm planning, I'm reframing, I'm trying to find some way to reason and rationalize for myself that everything's okay. And in doing that, I'm really distracted. I'm trying to do everything. Like, I'm halfway through reading 4 books, and I'm trying to play on my phone while I'm reading one of those books. And I'm thinking about, I should be over there doing that thing, and I don't want to miss that. So trying to do too many things at once. Trying to juggle too many projects at once. Trying to be interested in too many things at once. And you start to burn out. You start to run yourself into the ground. So it's the energy is very restless, anxious, overwhelmed, stressed, scattered. It's very, very much ADHD. So there's a lot of people get diagnosed with ADHD who are actually type 7s. They don't have a thing called ADHD. I'm not denying the existence of that, but pretty much all 7s that are fixated, and I mean all of them, if they went through the ADHD tests, would be shown to have ADHD. I think they'd have to drill them quite hard to find out it was something different. They'd have to drill down quite deep. And it's because of this scattered, can't focus, want to do everything. It's very distracted all the time. Find it very difficult to listen. Unless something's really got my attention and I'm fascinated by it, which 7s love, fascination. I love that awe, that feeling of, oh, wow, like, this is amazing. I'm fascinated by it. This is so interesting. Boom, that's like food for the mind, right? It all lights up. Yeah. Unless it's like that, like, oh, shiny thing.
This is what I find in myself as well. It's like when I'm around so many people, some people can listen really like to one conversation to the other. And I'm like, it's coming in, but it's not staying in. It's just whoosh, whoosh, whoosh. And then I'm like distracted with something else. And I'm distracted with something else. I'm looking here. I'm looking there. And then sometimes I just sit there and listen to them. Well, nothing's going in. I was like, okay, well, I just sit there because I don't want to be rude.
That's it. We've struggled to listen. I mean, this is a sign that we're getting fixated when we realize I'm not listening. So Emma will sometimes be speaking to me and then she's saying something quite important, but it's normally, I'm not just ignoring her. It's one of the things she's said. My mind's grabbed it and gone, oh,
yeah,
gone off on a tangent.
Story. Yeah.
And then I'm remembering this thing, and what does that mean to me, and how does that fit with that thing? Still talking.
Yeah. And then you're nodding while you're even experiencing that story in your head. It's like, oh, this is happening, that's happening. And then they're like, and then they're looking at you for an answer for something else, and you're like, laughing.
And somehow, as a seven, you will always get out of it because you're really good at talking out of things, very verbal, very good at talking our way out of things, making excuses, coming out as the good person at the end of it. Just get away with so much.
Yeah, I love that
which
skill,
is a good thing and a bad thing, right? It's good, but also it means that we don't take responsibility, which means that we end up with big holes in our life, big gaps. Yeah. So that's what it looks like. When you get healthy, it looks like wise, witty, intelligent, in ways that matter, like wisdom, intelligence. It looks like being able to juggle many things. All the things that you were distracted by over all the years when you were fixated, oh, this and that and this and that and that, you start to synthesize patterns. You start to see patterns. So let's say I've become an artist and I go, do you know what? I realized I'm a seven. I know that my growth now is to focus on one thing instead of trying to do everything. I'm going to focus on art. Oh, when I was learning that engineering thing ages ago, I can see a principle that was at play in that engineering that also applies to this art. Boom, I can just do it. And oh, that other thing when I was playing golf, there's a principle that was involved in that, which I can apply to this art. Oh, that's made me better at art.
Yeah.
And what happens is the type seven, when they get healthy, they'll choose one thing normally, but that one thing, they'll get really good at it really quickly. They can learn it. What might take somebody else a decade, they can learn it in 2 or 3 years and master it really quickly, because it's almost like their whole life has been research and finding patterns that help them master this one thing. But then what they'll normally do is what they call like cross-fertilizing these areas of interest. So it might be like, I love music, I love art, and I love exercise. And then you might pull it all together and create an exercise program that you've done all the artwork for yourself and the soundtrack. So you pull it all together and get a lot done. And then it'll be very innovative, very rare. And then they'll get it out far and wide. This is kind of the hallmark of a healthy seven.
Yeah, I kind of just resonate with the rapid transformation. Like, you know, I normally talk about my spiritual awakening. It's been 5 years and it's been, and that's like becoming very and then even with my podcast, you know, like once I'm fixated on it, I've got to get this series three out, 2 weeks, giving myself 3 weeks, bang bang bang, interviewed five people this week, next week is all editing everything, get it, it's out. It's done within weeks. Done. Bang, bang. You know? Whereas like research lumps, you know, some one of my friends, why don't you just take it slow? Like, you know, why don't you just get one person each week, two people? And I was like, no, that's too slow. That would take me months. I'm just like, I need to get it done so I can concentrate on other stuff when this is releasing.
Patience is not one of our virtues.
No, it's not. It's not. Yeah. But you got to learn it. I think what I find is like, when you go through the spiritual path and you kind of do really learn it, you know, when you become healthier, I do see the difference in me. Like when I'm doing work, patience is not there. But in life in general, I can hand it over to universe and say, that's fine. You know, that's when but not when I'm working. I need to get it. It stresses me out. The work stresses me out. Life is fine. It's fine.
Spoken like a true seven. In fact, it's really good. Everything's shiny and rosy.
Including the darkest time. All right, then I'm going to go fixate on like sitting with that pain, and I'm going to go through all of the, analyze the whole shit out of it. And then I'm out of it. I'm done.
Thanks for bringing that up as well. Because when we talk about levels of health, one of the things that will, there's a handful of things that will help each type move up those levels of health. Obviously observe everything instead of, you know, I always say see it, don't be it. Once you're looking at it, you're not it. So like see it, don't be it. But one of the ones for us is to sit with pain. So sevens are pain avoidant. and pleasure seeking. So that whole pain pleasure, we say that all people are doing it. We are the archetypal example of that. So always want the pleasure and never want the pain. So for us to sit in our pain, in our emotions, in our disappointment, in our sadness, in our fear, us sitting in that is our growth. When we sit in that, we start to, we stop skimming across the top of the water, the surface, you know. I saw a thing that referred to a seven as a superficial charlatan. And I thought, yeah, I get that. You know, it's like they're always looking at the silver lining on the cloud and never actually get into the depth and the nitty gritty of things. And and when we actually sit in that pain, we become more relatable. We become more real. We become more authentic. We have more depth. Our charisma and likability is, it comes from a different place. Then it's not like, oh, I love that person, but only in small doses. I love how bubbly and vibrant and how much energy they bring to the, you know, to the to the room and to the situation. But let's just have a chiller tonight. Don't invite them. You know, it goes from that to actually people just want you around all the time, regardless of the event, because you're grounded. You're not just constantly in this manic mode. You're grounded and still joyful. You know.
Yeah, I was talking to you and Emma about this. I think a year ago when we were going through my my type, and like I was telling you, like before my awakening, it was just that, not sitting with the pain whatsoever, ignore it, or get into watching something or playing games all the time and video games, and just to avoid that trauma and pain, you know. And it's the next level, like pop culture, just like they're like some anything but have a deep conversation, anything but have a deep conversation. But then
often we'd think we're having a deep conversation, right? Sometimes there's a seven, but our depth is let's explore all the potentials and possibilities. And like we'd describe as, oh, we had a really deep conversation, but it wasn't a deep, heartfelt, connected conversation with somebody heart to heart about real stuff that mattered, right? It's concepts and fun and things that we find interesting. And that's a different kind of deep conversation, isn't it?
Yeah, definitely seeing the difference from where I was to where I'm now. And I've still got work to do, but it's not, I try not to say it's got work to do. It's like, let it happen. Because it's like, then you'll be like, once you get fixated on it, I know I do get fixated even in personal development. It's like, oh, need to better myself, better. Like, I do have a massive transformation, but it goes through a rapid turbulence of emotions and trauma releasing, and then I have a period where it's absolutely incredible, feel fresh and alive, and then on to the next thing and to the next trauma, you know. So it's like in the last couple of years, and that's like it's a year or so, I had to just kind of just hold back on diving deep too much, you know. So balancing that out now.
Is key. This is what getting healthy is. It's balance.
Absolutely.
It's not doing your personality really good. It's finding balance. It's being able to embody the qualities of all the types.
I do love the extreme version of it, though. It's like I absolutely love it because I get everything done so fast. I love it. I love thriving in it. But I think people around me kind of just like, oh no, this is a bit too much. You know, if they're moving at a slower pace and they like seem like they're balancing their life, it's like, and I'm like, whoosh, like a lightning bolt. Oh, but yeah, it's good.
Flash.
Flash, literally Flash superhero. So how can it help people in real world? How can it help you guys? How did it help you in real life?
Yeah, so briefly, part of the symbol is a triangle, which you can see. That's a triangle. That represents something called the law of three, which is, you can say it's your thesis, the status quo, the normal for me, the familiar, this is how I am, this is normal, this is what is the home for me. That over there is the opposite. That's the antithesis. That's the opposite. That's them. That's the other people like that. I'm not like that. Then you've got the third part of the triangle, which is synthesis, which is can be both. And this is what all types are doing. I'm like this. for us. I'm joyous and enthusiastic and fun. I'm not one of those sad, quiet people that are all withdrawn. I get in the thick of it and I make waves. And so we're kind of, our thesis would be to be vibrant, positive and energetic. And the antithesis would be low energy, sad, disappointed, in the low emotions, serious, boring, as we'd call it, but serious. And actually, synthesis, it teaches us we've got to learn to be both. And when we bring them both together and we allow ourselves to be both those things at the same time, not literally at the same time, but we have access to it all at the same time. And then we can choose where on that spectrum do we want to be. Oh, the circumstances and events call for me to be in the low end. That's appropriate. That's healthy. That needs to be addressed. That's where I need to be. And I can go there effortlessly. I'm just there. That's it. Cool. And then, right, time to go back to joyous. I can do that. We're at a party. Everyone's having fun. Okay, somebody's dog just died. Go over to the sad. Go over to be able to sit with them in their pain and not try to cheer them up and go, it's all right, though. You know, you can get another job. Another dog. He had a good innings, didn't he? Lived a long time and constantly try to see the bright side, which is what we do when we're stuck in our type. But to be able to actually come down and inhabit the other end. So this is how you use it in the real world. This is how it affects you in the real world. It's you realize what your pattern is, what your type keeps doing, and you with presence choose to do the most appropriate thing rather than the thing that you've always done. And in that, how that's helped me, just to give an example, then hopefully anyone who's listening to this now has a good feel for what a type seven is like, this vibrant energy. And it's all about spontaneity and freedom and don't tie me down. Don't tell me what to do. I want to do what I want, when I want, and I want to do all the fun stuff. So how it's helped me, first of all, is to stop running, to stop running from responsibility, to stop running from pain, to stop running from anxiety, to stop running from conflict, to stop running from structure. And actually to start to see things like self-discipline, focus and structure and responsibility as keys to freedom, because they are. Because all that spontaneity is only freedom in the short term, but it leads to having normally crap finances, terrible finances. I've not done my savings. I've not, established myself in any kind of a business or career, because I've been flitting around doing this thing and that thing. So I kind of get old then, and I'm a jack of all trades, master of none, no money in the bank, no prospects really. And it's like, So this is what it's taught me. It's in a very real, pragmatic, practical way. It's choose one or two things that you really love, that you're really passionate about. Enneagram is one of them. And see it through all the way. Go really, really, really deep into it. The whole kit and caboodle, like type five does. Go all the way in. And don't get distracted. When you see something that distracts you, go, not now, I'm doing this. Push it away. Push it away. If it keeps coming back and it becomes a sign where it's like, you really, really need to deal with this, maybe give it some attention and explore it, but don't dive all the way in and put that down, you know? So there's a lot of time people will tell me things about like human design and other stuff, and I'm always like, oh, I really want to get into that. And it's like, nope, stick with what I'm doing. Someone else can go share master that and share it with the world. I'm here to master this and share this with the world, . Which is easier said than done for a seven, right? It's that fear of missing out of what if that's the thing that's going to scratch my itch? So to focus on choosing one thing, having routine, wake up at the same time every day, work out, eat at certain times of day, have structure, go to bed at a certain time of day. This to my old self was, oh God, I hate people like that. They're so boring. I know.
Same.
Whereas now it's like I realize this is my route to freedom, because until I master something and I give my whole self to something, I'll never get anywhere. But when I do that, suddenly now I have this abundant lifestyle. It's balanced, it's built around something that I love. I'm grounded, I've grown roots, and I know where I'm at now. I know what I'm doing, I have clarity. And with all that, comes with responsibility, right? I have to be responsible now. Mm. I've got people doing a 3-year course with me, an Enneagram course, and now I have to be responsible and look after those people to the very best of my ability for 3 whole years. I can't go off the rails. I can't just go off traveling. And actually, that's my growth. That feels like freedom now, that being able to lock into something. Because a lot of freedom is I can do anything I want. Mm. But before, I didn't have the option to take responsibility. Mm. I didn't have that option. I couldn't give myself that. Whereas now I have that as an option, so I'm free. I can do that as and when I please. I can say no to myself, right? Mm. So I say as and when I please. It's getting better. It's not all the way there. Yeah. I love flapjack.
I love the love the responsibility side. So it's I feel like I'm getting to that level of I am getting to that level, especially with this podcast. Whereas it's really showing me like, oh, you got these like amazing guests coming on. Like in my mind, they're big guns, right? You need to deliver. You need to be responsible now. You can't be doing halfway and then just legging it. You have to do it now. And I was like, I was sitting on my bum and I was like, I have to do it. And it's the freedom, liberation. And that's where the creativity is coming. It's like, I'm really focused, like the type 5. Really focusing on it, like really going to that. It's like yesterday I was saying like, oh, what could go there? What could go there? What could go there? What can I say? What could, when I was editing, how can I create that so the video isn't small? And it's like it's opened up so many different channels. Whereas before, a year and a half ago, when I stopped doing the podcast, before that, when I had the series 1 and 2, I just didn't put as much effort. I was like interviewing people, but it's like, just putting it up, sake of putting it up. Whereas now I'm really like really focused on it and I'm enjoying it. I'm really enjoying it. You know,
I'm glad you are.
Yeah.
Because, you know, there's real deep fulfillment and contentment and passion and enjoyment versus pleasure and thrills. And you know, all that side of stuff, you know, hedonism. And I lived a hedonistic lifestyle for a long time, and travel and escapism and intoxication and stuff like that, and that never scratched the itch like this does. And this is what you're talking about, right? Having that clear direction and purpose and meaning, and being able to commit and throw yourself into it. It touches something that all that other stuff never touches, right? That pleasure
I feel like type 7 would really like have a lot of type 5s. They would benefit from them, really. Like, you know, type 5s will just tell you straight up and will show you, and you're like, oh, I want to learn, I want to do this, I'm going to start a business and just continue with it.
Just briefly on the Enneagram, it does work like that. So for anybody, if you can still see this, seven is there. I don't know if you can hear me. Seven's there. One is there.
On the opposite, because this is going to be audio as well. So.
Okay. Yeah. So there's a symbol. There's lines within the symbol. Right? It almost looks like a pentagram or a star or something, right? So where the seven is, there's a line that goes to the one, and then there's another line that goes from the seven to the five. And it, basically, when somebody is in stress as a seven, they move and become like a one. They become pedantic, frustrated, finicky, kind of, it's not right, it needs to be better. Oh, that's it now. I've messed about too much. I need to rein it in and have some responsibility, and we get kind of uptight. And this is what a fixated one is like. And then when we're in growth, we become like a healthy five, which is hyper-focused. I know what I want. I'm going all the way in. I'm exploring the depth. I've got this amazing focus. I'm not trying to do everything all the time. So this doesn't make any type better than any other. It's just that under stress, we become like a fixated one, and under growth, we become like a healthy five. Mm. And this is what I meant by it's moving and it's dynamic. Because in certain periods of your life, you move down those lines and become like the type at the other end of it under certain conditions, which is another guide or a signpost for what to do to get well. So it's like, oh, so when I'm in growth, I'm like a five. What do fives do? The focus. Okay, so I can see that I need to focus more.
So being really aware of where you're at is probably the best place to be, because then you know where you can move to. So if you're not in your growth, then it's like, okay, well, I need to go to, move to. Yeah.
And then we also look down the line at the one that's like, in our example, it'd be a one. And it's like, so what's the one teaching me? They're teaching me to have self-discipline, to have to have this structure, and to be able to say no to myself, because that's what ones are like.
Mm.
And they want to do a good job and do it right and see to all the details. And so they teach us that as well. So if we look down the lines, what are the lessons coming from there? That's what we need. Focus and self-discipline, ultimately. We need more of that. And then same with the ones that are on the side. So we have a six on one side and an eight on the other. The six teaches us to be committed and to commit to things and stay loyal to things. And the eight tells us to take things a little bit more seriously and go after what it is that you want and, you know, and follow through.
Yeah. So yeah. Oh, my God. Come. Yeah. I was like, we still haven't barely touched the surface of this, because there are wings as well that we can talk about. I mean, like our type seven. So wings, very quickly, like, because obviously we, I've got other questions as well. So, so wings are basically you. So if we're type seven, you could either be a wing eight or wing six. Is that correct?
Yes. Seven wing eight or seven wing six.
So it has to be your neighbor number. Yes.
That's it.
The secondary. Absolutely. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. So if you're a seven wing six, you're a seven who, imagine like a rainbow. It goes red, orange, yellow, green, blue, indigo, violet. And it, red to orange, it kind of goes through the whole red, orange to orange, red. You know, there's like all the different shades in between there. And it's the same with types. So even though you will be primarily one type, you might be a red that's quite orange, or an orange that's quite red. So it could be a seven that's quite six-ish, or a seven that's quite eight-ish, which brings another quality to your type. So the seven with an eight wing is known as the realist, and the seven with a six wing is known as the entertainer. So realist versus entertainer is two different energies.
Oh, wow. Okay. So you can just tap into this, like, multiple personalities as well. This is like in laptop.
Oh, yeah. There's loads more to it. Subtypes and things as well.
Oh,
it goes
my
much
God.
Deeper,
but... We're going to have to get you on another time and explain everything. Well, this is like part two.
Three-year course.
Yeah. Yeah. Bring the course to this podcast. It'll be fine. So have you talked about what areas of life it can affect?
What I love about the Enneagram is it will affect all the areas of your life. The reason being is 9 times out of 10, or let's even probably say something like 98 times out of 100, probably your problems are not based on what's happened. They're based on how you're processing what's happened. And they're also, the problems that you have are often based on the actions you're taking and where you're putting yourself and how you're showing up. So as you get healthy as your type, you will put yourself in healthier positions around healthier people, make healthier choices. When problems come to you, you will be more dynamic. You won't lean into your type and get really unhealthy. You will draw upon all the qualities of all the types, and you'll be able to be way more flexible in dealing with those problems. So this applies to everything. So let's say, obviously, your mental health is better when you work with the Enneagram and you use it to pick apart your personality and let go of all them coping strategies, literally coming out of coping and surviving and into balanced thriving. So this is very literally what we're doing. It does affect, obviously, your relationships, because it's been incredible for my relationship, which, you know, is my other thing, right? It's my really important thing. It's very difficult for me to help somebody in relationships to the depth I would like to without them knowing their Enneagram type, because you can see how you're hurting your partner. You can see how you're hurting yourself. You can see, I've touched on it earlier, right, about we need to be less averse to people's wanting a reaction to their reactivity. And it's up to them to work on their reactivity, but we need to be able to deal with it and understand they can't help it, you know.
But what if, like, you're met in a situation where the other person doesn't want to work at theirs, but you're working, but you're still getting a lot of their stuff onto you? And that doesn't work, does it?
No, I mean, it can do, because we can. And my other area of focus, obviously being a seven, we have several, is self-regulation, but it all fits together. Relationships, if you have a good regulated nervous system, you have healthy relationships, and you're extremely self-aware, and you're working with your Enneagram type, they're three things that are going to move you up those levels of health. And that's my three areas of focus. So in relationship with somebody, when you're in someone's presence, if your nervous system is regulated, it regulates theirs, or it helps regulate theirs, right? It's called co-regulation. We have a thing called neuroception, where our nervous systems literally speak to one another. Your nervous system's deciding, is this person a threat? Do they have something up their sleeve? Can I trust them? Or are they trustworthy, calm, approachable, safe? Mm-hmm. And so when you're in a very regulated state, you're positively impacting the people around you. And when they feel safe, because you feel safe, then they come out of the coping mechanisms and you're going to get a healthier version of them.
Mm-hmm.
So to co-regulate, to regulate yourself in other people's presence is good. And also, if you're in the fixations of your personality, they will put their mask on and be in their personality. Whereas when you come out of yours somewhat, and you've come from a very authentic place, you speak into the authenticity within them. And so they'll be able to put theirs down a little bit as well. That makes sense. So you can bring out the best in another person, but you can't control
also,
them.
It's like, you know, it's knowing that, oh, okay, I'm this Enneagram type, or I'm this personality type, I'm just that, and I'm not gonna do anything with it, you know. So, you know, you do have to, sometimes you have to work, like you said, from unhealthy to healthy. If you want to become the better version of yourself, you got to do that, you know. Not just knowing, walking around with information, you know. It's just doing that work, and absolutely, oftentimes it's hard work. It's internal. That's where trauma work comes in, everything, childhood wounds comes in, like we talked about.
Information is not transformation, is what I always say. You know, you've got to do something about it. And, you know, Enneagram is really, really well known in the world. It's huge. But I'd say, like, the very vast majority of people just wear their type like a badge. Oh, I'm this. They're not doing anything with it. They're not using it. But that's okay. You know, I'm not, I don't want to judge. You can see where they're at on the levels of health. That's all. That level of health does that. And then if grace comes in and helps them, or they have to overcome a challenge and it helps them develop something, awakens something within them, they'll go up to the next level of health, and then they'll go, oh, show me more about this. I can see now, I need to know more about this. Does that make sense?
Yeah, integrating just, that,
just because we're healthier doesn't make us better. And as a sexual seven, they call it, and I won't get into it, but my dominant driving instinct is sexual as opposed to social or self-preservation. As a sexual seven, it's very easy for me to fall into the trap of superiority and competitiveness and wanting to one up people, and thinking ahead of the game and trying to run rings around people and things like that. So it's kind of been a bit of an awakening for me to look at those levels of health, because I realized I took my ego from some places and I put it into that. Oh, I'm really healthy and wise. I'm really developed, and I just transferred it into this new ego, you know. So I have to kind of watch that like a hawk, because that comes on online dead easily. And to not judge people for where they're at, because, you know, it's not relevant.
Ultimately, it goes down to taking responsibility of your own wound, right? And that is it. Like, you know, I've been, when I was working with you guys, like we did like attachment styles and things like that. So since then, I've been like a year and a half, I've been like ended up in a relationship, but then I've been working on those wounds, you know, going in as like every time my wound of abandonment, because anxious attached is always like a wound of abandonment is quite strong, going in, have an internal family system session, memories, working with memories with like everything that's been coming up, you know, the childhood trauma. Now I can really, really happily say that I feel so anchored. I said that in one of my videos the other day. It's like I've never been this anchored in my entire life. I've never felt it. It's like that. Don't get me wrong, here and there I get pulls, but it's not as intense and triggering as it was. But yeah, it's just incredible work. You know, you got to do that inner work to really know the benefits of it, you know.
The IFS is another example, isn't it, of looking at it instead of from it.
It's
another example.
Really going in. really going in.
Gives these parts of you a bit almost like a character that you can look at. And so it's no longer governing you. It's just a part of you that you get to witness and talk to and communicate with. So it's very similar. It's really useful, isn't it?
Yeah,
so
absolutely.
Other areas, obviously, relationships and your mental health and obviously physical health, because you make better choices when you're healthy, when you're mentally well and emotionally well. And career. I mean, of course, most people fall into a career, don't they? Of what can I get? What's the best thing I can get now that is going to pay the bills? Whereas I feel like the more evolved you get, or the more healthy you get, or the more balanced you become, the more you find yourself in a space of, like, I'm able to just go do what I want to do. You know, I want to do something. I have the mindset, the motivation, the self-belief, and everything to actually get that, go with it, make it happen, use it to help the world. Like, something shifts inside, right? And you realize that I'm here for more than just doing this job that I was doing before. So it really helps with that. It helps with life choices in general, like knowing which way to turn in life, because you're thinking clearly, you're thinking more balanced, you're not looking through the narrow, you know, the narrow kind of tunnel vision perspective of your type. You've opened up and seen way more, so you have more vision. You make choices more clearly, and you choose better environments, you choose better friendships, you choose to show up better in your friendships and in the environments.
Completely agree.
Affects everything.
Yeah, 100%, 100%. So where can people start then?
Yeah, so anyone who's been listening to this and you're like, okay, get me some of that. I want to know more. There is, you're lucky, because there's a plethora of Enneagram-related stuff out there, right from the fun stuff that's more surface, that's like, oh, I'm that type, you know, the thing, the traps that the type fall into, and it might be a little bit surface stuff, or it might be more things that this type really don't want you to know, and it's playful and it's fun, and they've got little cartoons that go with it and things like that. So if you want to go in and look at all that stuff that's entertaining and useful, you know, it is useful, I'm not saying it's not. If you want to go in at that level, that's all there. There's loads of on Instagram, and there is YouTube videos and all sorts. It's everywhere.
Yeah, you can do tests as well, right?
And the memes and stuff. And you can do tests online.
Yeah.
Don't trust the typing tests 100%. They're only about 60-70% accurate. You better working with somebody to help you find your type. If you want the deep stuff and you really want to go deep on it, then you can go as deep as you want. There's lots of books out there. There is websites that are really good. I would recommend the Enneagram Institute is pretty good. Dr. David Daniels is somebody else who goes really deep. And myself and Emma, my partner, the stuff we put out, we go for the deep stuff and less of the surface stuff. There's lots of books. So if you're into things like this, the spiritual dimension of the Enneagram. What's this one? The Keys to the Enneagram, which is how to unlock the highest potential of every personality type. If you're a coach, you can do coaching people with the Enneagram. Got all the deep stuff, better parenting with the Enneagram. So this is a little bit, it's not as deep, but it's useful, it's practical. What else we got? The Enneagram's Guide to Waking Up. Loads of books out there that are really, really good. I love Beatrice Chestnut. She's a really good teacher, a really good writer. I've got another one of hers there, The Complete Enneagram. This is Beatrice, she's really good. Anything with Russ Hudson and Don Riso, anything with A.H. Almas, if you want to go really into the deeper spiritual aspects. This stuff's very deep. If you're not into the depth of stuff, don't start there, it won't make sense. And then somebody called Sandra Maitre, these are all our favorite teachers, again, all the spiritual stuff. A.H. Almas and Sandra Maitre know each other, and they're friends, and they learned it together many years ago from one of the forefathers of it, of the model.
Amazing. And also, you have course as well, right? So if anybody wants to dive deep with you, then they can come to you.
So what we do is we take the teachings of all of these, plus our own Enneagram teacher, who's Khaled El Shabini. I'd just like to give you know, props where it's due and reference. But if you want to dive in, yeah, there's all the books, there's loads of websites, and we do have a course where we take all this information and put it all together in a way that's so we help people go through a holistic transformation. We get the body involved and with the breath involved, and we go through all the deep psychological and the levels of development and the spiritual development, what spiritual awakening looks like for each type, and take people through this process. Our course is 3 years long, but you can do 1 year, 2 years, or 3 years, or you could even do one semester, which is a third of a year. But we totally recommend people do at least 1 year to get a real deep transformative experience from it. And yes, you can find us on Instagram, Enneagram_Mickey and Emma. Mickey is MICKEY, and it's the word and. So Enneagram_Mickey and Emma. Probably a good place to find us. It's simple. And from there, you can click through and see all our other stuff as well.
Oh, amazing. Oh, my God. I was going to say, how can people contact you? But then you already said it. So do you remember? Did I do the rapid fire questions with you last time? I can't remember.
I'm not sure.
Yeah, let's do it. Okay. I've got quick rapid fire questions for you before we finish. What is your definition of universe, God, life?
Stuff that's happening right now. Okay. my mind just went. My definition is there is a very, very incomprehensibly intricate intelligence. It's mathematical and it's intelligent and it knows exactly what it's doing and it is extremely perfect in everything it does. It's meticulous, it's immaculate in every single way.
Beautiful. What do you think happens when you die?
We go out of this body and into the causal realm, which is the realm of archetypes. And this is where our spirit guides are, if you believe in things like angels and this kind of realm, the Akashic records. So I feel we go into the Akashic records.
Amazing.
And choosing the next life from there.
Beautiful. How do you define religion and spirituality?
Spirituality is something that some people have been fortunate enough to experience a profound spiritual awakening. The people around them saw that person go through that shift and saw how they were, and then tried to emulate how that person was because they wanted to be like that person.
So but they didn't have that experience themselves.
They didn't have the experience. Yeah. They tried to emulate the results of it. And then power came in and corrupted that and used it a little bit as well.
Oh, wow. I haven't heard of that one before, but that's brilliantly explained. What's the lesson that took you the longest to learn?
The one probably that I'm still learning. Does that count?
Yeah.
The one that I'm still learning is, how can I word this? To be able to truly be thoughtful, to be more other person focused, because I'm ultimately type sevens are all self-focused, and when they feel like they're not.
Yeah.
And this, to really, really be thoughtful and think about other people. I mean, I help other people for a living, but to actually get in their world
deep from the heart. Yeah.
Yeah. It's a really hard one.
Yeah. Do you believe that people with horrible beginnings end up creating the best features?
I think it's possible that they do, but certainly that they don't always, because some people go on to repeat their own tragic childhoods. I was abused as a child, I go on to be an abuser. So that can happen. I think many people who achieve some level of greatness in their life, having a big positive worldly impact, I think probably most of those people had a really challenging upbringing.
Beautiful. I am fully in present moment when?
This is going to sound stupid, but when I'm in the gym.
Well, it's not stupid. It's like,
of all things, though, I mean, like, yeah, probably when I'm in the gym and during climax.
Oh, this is amazing.
This is like the two times, and I'm just completely, I don't want to be anywhere else. I'm so, oh, and more recently, when I'm looking into my son's eyes and he's laughing and smiling, his little face, I don't want to look anywhere else, and I don't want him to stop smiling.
Yeah.
But I mean, for elongated time, like just at the gym for some reason, it's my thing at the moment.
It's quite interesting you said that, because I was literally just before I got on, it's like I was sending my friend a voice note, like, I'm joining a gym. Did you know I'm joining a gym? Universe is saying, well, yeah, you are. Your other type 7 says so. Yeah, that's like another thing I'm doing with a million things. Do you believe that there is an end to healing?
Yeah, in a way. It depends how you define healing. We'd have to be very clear about the definition of that word. I think there's a point where healing becomes evolution. It's like, am I just healing traumas now, or I'm actually undoing being a human being and actually going into a whole other realm of potential and possibility, you know, human beings as we know it. I mean, like I've now healed to be a healthy human being, but then there's lots more after that. Yeah. You know, there's going to unity, isn't there, to oneness, to all that is. And I think that's way ahead of being a healed human being.
Beautiful. The world needs more of what?
This is going to be a very seven-ish answer, but first of all,
spontaneous.
It needs less bureaucracy, but it needs more opportunity for people to express their deepest purpose. So instead of feeling like they need to go get on the treadmill and get a job to pay the bills, we need to all have enough financial stability and support and safety so that we can focus on our core genius, the thing that we're here to really be and do.
Beautiful. So if there was someone going through spiritual awakening, dark night of the soul, and they're going through a really adverse period of their time, what would you say to them?
I would say, let people in, get support, let people help you. Don't turn them into the enemy, because you're prone to doing that, because you're in victimhood and you're going to make enemies out of people and think people are doing bad by you. But find some good, trustworthy people, let them in, allow yourself to lean on them somewhat, and cut all the negativity out of your life. Don't watch the news, don't read newspapers, don't gossip, don't listen to negative stuff, and read all the healthy material you can get, watch all the inspirational videos you can get, eat as healthily as you can, get plenty of rest and exercise.
Yeah. Oh, amazing. I mean, like, I know, like, whenever I go through something, and you're always the person I kind of just go to, and like recently you were, like, you know, when I was going through it, and your basic, like, it was like the basic of the basic, you got to do this, you got to regulate your body, you got to do, you got to eat properly, and I did that, and it was just like, it's great to have, like, you know, people, like you said, people who will come and lift you up, and they will lift you up with knowledge, you know, rather than gossiping when you're down and you're gossiping. So, you know, for example, if someone is going through something, then, oh, they had a fight with a sibling, or they with their partner, or they went through a breakup, the people will come in and just justify you. But then there's other people, it's like, come in with wisdom, with both involved parties involved. Yeah.
Thanks for saying that, because that's important. Different people for different roles. Sometimes you want someone who will just listen, and then you want other people who are going to give you good, solid wisdom or advice or knowledge, or be able to point you in the direction of something, or somebody who's resourced. So you want some people who are really good at holding that space, and some people who are really well resourced, I think.
Yeah, beautiful. Beautiful. Oh, you've already said your contact, but do you want to share a bit more? So how can people contact you?
Yeah, so I have an email address as well, which is info@mickeyandemma, spelled how I said before, Mickey and Emma. So info@mickeyandemma is our email. Enneagram_mickeyandemma is our Instagram. And also we're on Facebook. We tend to use Facebook for most of our stuff. That tends to be our main outlet. So it's facebook.com/MickeyOwen1.
Mm-hmm. Amazing.
That's the number one.
Amazing. Oh, thank you so much, bro, for coming on. It's I feel like I still need to keep bringing you on because there's so much other knowledge, and then we can talk about relationships with Enneagrams, and like it's like, yeah, you're gonna be like a regular in the series, I guess, the whole podcast series. Yeah. But yeah, thank you so much for sharing your wisdom and knowledge, and I'm sure like lots of people will take so much from you today, and hoping that they will just dive into their own Enneagram types and finding out a bit more and how to work with that energy and how to work, you know, from if they feel that they're healthy, how to get to healthy. But yeah, thank you.
Thanks so much for helping create a better world for Charlie to grow up in and for us all to live in, you know. It's one of the good ones that are doing that with us and for us. I appreciate you a lot. Thank you.
Oh, thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for listening to this episode. I would absolutely love to know what your biggest takeaway from this conversation has been. You can share your thoughts on my Facebook or Instagram, Madiha Sosan. If you would like to listen to this episode, I am on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, and many, many more. Just search Soul Awakenings with Madiha Sosan. If you enjoyed this episode, then please do rate and share this with your family and friends, as that will help me out a lot. Thank you so much once again, and I will see you in the next episode.